We're here to talk about your book, which is about your guitar. And I don't think anybody has a story like you have about the instrument that is part of you, really, isn't it?
It really is, yeah. I had it in my mind to do the story for a long time, you know, going back 20, 30 years. But it happened because other people said, look, we have to do this. And so I was kind of dragged into it feet first, which is nice. And Simon actually set about writing it as opposed to just talking about writing it. And they interviewed me, so that was the way I was able to contribute. We did a number of interviews and he transcribed it and worked it all into a format. And then at the very last moment, because I'd been busy, you know, and I doing so much stuff, I said, just look, give me a couple of days. And I went through the whole thing and did my editing and my little additions, trying to look for places where there were things that were missed out. And there it was, gone. You know, so suddenly it was out there. Now, left to myself, I never would have done this. I never would have, you know, it would have taken years and years because there's so many other things that I'm writing and doing. But I'm really happy that that it got made, that the book is there.
It's wonderful as you know, as a fan, to look at it and to read it, because I knew that you had built it with your dad and I knew that that was the guitar, but I didn't really know anything else. But the level of detail in this book is, I mean, I should expect that from you, because you're a man with a great brain. But
thank you.
But it's the level of detail that you have shared in there, you know, the different stages, the photos, the different stages, but the written stuff as well.
Good. Well, I'm hoping it will be helpful to anyone who is either making their own guitar or else getting the best out of the guitar that they have, because a lot of the things which make so much difference to the sound and the feel and the way you can play are small things. You know, just tiny little adjustments can make a huge difference, and you have to know what you're aiming at. So to get the thing to keep its tune, for instance, you know, and the whole tremolo thing, and to have it so that it will feed back in the way that you want it to feed back as a rock player, all these things depend on the smallest little things. So I'm hoping that people will find things in there and go, oh, yeah, okay, I'll do that with my guitar and see what happens. So it's a kind of, it's a dream come true to be able to share this stuff with people in an organized way.
And there it is.
And there is me red special, yeah, and the old lady.
It's for anyone who doesn't know, how old were you when you sort of came up with this idea with your dad?
I was 17, and my dad was a great electronics engineer and a craftsman. So me and my dad set about making the guitar. Really, it happened because we couldn't afford a guitar. I couldn't afford a Stratocaster or a Gibson or whatever, and we thought, we can make a guitar. Maybe we can make something that's better than anybody's ever made. You know, my dad had that attitude, which I inherit. You know, for things worth doing, it's worth doing properly. And I kind of extend that. I think, you know, for things worth doing, it's worth overdoing. So that's kind of a Queen thing. but this guitar evolved in the hands of me and my dad. We had no power tools. We had no experience in making guitars. We just did a few experiments and tried out various methods, and the materials we used were all things that were just lying about. So literally the oak panel, which takes the strain here, is from an old tabletop. The neck is from a fireplace which was 100 years old at the time, so it's about 300 years old now. You can still see the wormholes, which were filled in with matchsticks, and this was all just done with spoke shaves and sandpaper and chisels. And
weren't I really like the story about the dot markers.
The dot markers were from my mum's button box.
And mum's in there too.
Ah, my mum's in there. And this is from one of my mum's large knitting needles. And the way I would fashion something like this was to get a drill and put the thing in a drill, turn the drill, and work the file here. So it's a kind of homemade hand-powered lathe.
Right.
And I made these little rollers here the same way. And I think this was the first guitar in the world to have a tremolo that actually had almost zero friction because of the rollers here. And because of the fact that the strings go through here almost parallel and are only constrained vertically by one thing, this zero fret.
So just as I'm completely fascinated right now, in when you began touring with Queen, when Queen were first on the road, were people, other guitarists, just as fascinated? Did you get people sort of saying, oh, can I have a look at your guitar?
Yeah, it's always been a talking point, and people like to pick it up and see what it's like. And they go, oh my God, the neck's thick, you know, which it is. So I like a thick neck. That's the way I like to feel things. But once they get playing with these switches, they all go, ah, I need that on my guitar, because this is new too. Nobody'd ever done this actual, what can I call it, this configuration, this way of configuring the pickups in any way you want, because most pickups in those days were just wired up to a single switch, and so you would have maybe three positions on the switch, like a Telecaster or a Stratocaster. But actually, the combinations you can get out of three pickups, in and out of phase, are very many. So I had a separate switch for each pickup and a separate phase switch for each pickup, and you can get a lot of combinations. It means you have an incredibly wide variation of tone, of sound.
Because when you were just playing up there before, it sounded like there were about three of you.
Well, there were three of me, because I had delays on here.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's one of the things I love to play with, and I have for years and years. So I have a single delay, which comes out one side, and I have another single delay, which is twice the length, on the other side. And you can play along and do various things rhythmically and make harmonies and stuff. And it's something I get lost in. And
I can imagine, because I mean, I could get lost in listening to it. If you were still playing now, I'd be like, oh, it's all right, it's fine.
That's good. Well, yeah, I enjoy it. You know, there's so many things you can do with a guitar. And I think more and more I've been enjoying the fact that the guitar can speak almost without you touching it. You know, the higher you make the feedback loop, the more the guitar will just spontaneously burst into certain kind of sounds. And playing with that is fascinating to me. So you can mix the sounds which the guitar spontaneously puts out with the things that you want to play.
One thing I never quite understood, and probably till about 5 years ago, until I started really talking to people like yourself, is I always thought that you would have about three or four of these. I didn't realize that people had one guitar and it was there, that was the big one. I assume there were lots of copies because they were being, you know, transported around the world, and you were frightened that someone might drop one, but well, this is, it's the only one.
Yeah, well, I do have copies, you know, and for certain things, obviously I need a spare if I break a string. Yeah. And I have a copy which has a lowered E string, you know, a drop D tuning. And I have a couple of new ones, one which sounds very much like an acoustic guitar, which is a lot of fun, but this is the one, yes. And I remember when we first started touring, a friend of mine who was a journalist at the time, he said, this is great, he said, but don't take your guitar on the road, you know. And I thought, well, if I don't take the guitar, there's a piece of me missing, so I have to do that. And luckily it survived, you know. I touch wood every time I say that, you know. It's partly because Pete takes such good care of it, you know, my tech, he guards it with his life on the road, which is fantastic. And amazingly, it still works.
Yeah.
You know, this thing has never been refretted in its life, which is...
I like the fact that it looks a little bit used, but not too used.
It sure is used, yeah. Now it's well used, it's well loved and well used. But that's something that nobody can believe. You know, a lot of guitarists that I speak to, they went, oh, you must have refretted it. I go, no, nope, never.
Wow.
And these frets are the ones that I bought from Clifford Essex for, I don't know, threepence a foot at the time. Clifford Essex was a little shop in Cambridge Circus called Banjo, Mandolin and Guitar.
That's around there.
Yeah, it's gone now.
Yeah,
just over here. And I went in and I bought my fret wire and I bought the machine heads. Now, the machine heads I've replaced because machine heads do wear out. Mm. But most of this guitar's had a little bit of a top coat, refurbishment by my excellent Australian friend Greg. But pretty much this is the guitar that I made. There's nothing really changed in, I don't know, how many years? 30 years? Maybe more than that. No, 40 years. 40 years.
If you play other guitars, does it feel strange or not?
I can play other guitars, but this is really like an extension of me, so nothing quite feels like this one. I mean, we make some good copies now. You know, I now have the Brian May Guitars company, and the guitars which we sell are very close to this, and I take a great pride in making sure that people get a quality instrument for not too much money. So it's a bit of fun. I mean, it doesn't really make us money, but it sort of perpetuates the line, and there are quite a lot of ideas in this guitar which are original, so the guitar has the guitar can do things which other guitars can't.
Yeah. My final question, really, and I know a lot of people compose on acoustic guitar or compose on piano, or if you could, you are you able to tell me a couple of Queen tracks that you use this to sort of pick out the ideas of?
Yeah, some tracks get written around the guitar because your hands just fall into certain places, like that's the riff for Hammer to Fall. Uh-huh. So yes, it was written around that riff, and of course
I'd like to do the little yell at the beginning. No, not going to. That's my. That is actually my favourite Queen song.
Oh, really?
Tie Your Mother Down. Tie Your Mother Down. I saw the Foo Fighters cover it live,
yeah.
And it was what an amazing song, because it's got legs, like for someone else to do it like that. But yeah. I've seen you do it as well.
Yeah, it makes me happy. Well, that was written on a guitar, and it was written on an acoustic guitar actually, which I had, and I was a student up in. On a mountain ridge in Tenerife, working on my astronomy PhD, and that riff, for some reason, came into my head. And
it's amazing.
So yeah, and I always remember taking it to Freddie, playing it to Freddie, and he goes, "Well, what's it called? What's the words?" And I went, "Well, all I have at the moment is 'Tie Your Mother Down,' which obviously we can't use." And he went, "Yeah, we can. What's wrong with that?" You know? So then I thought about it, and I thought, "Tie Your Mother Down. Yeah, it means something. It means like for a kid." You know, break out from the strangling influence of your parents. So it became a song very much about what every kid wants to do, which is to break out, I suppose, you know, in a kind of humorous way. You know, it's a fun song, but it's basically about, yeah, just keep your parents out of this and we'll do what we do.
Brian, it's been absolutely wonderful to sit here, not just with you, but with the Red Special.
With my baby.
Well, yeah, absolutely. Just finally, is it... Would you ever have a go at making another one?
I doubt it. I did make one other guitar. I made a little Hawaiian guitar, a sort of steel guitar, which I still have. Much simpler arrangement than this. I don't think I would make another one, though. There's too many other things I need to do in this life before I check out, you know, and a lot of it's to do with animals. You know, I've become more and more aware that something has to be done about the way we live and the way that we're... abusing every other creature on this planet. So to me, it's become a real matter of urgency and priority to try and give animals a voice. In fact, there was just a report from the World Wildlife Fund, I don't know if you saw that recently, which says during the last 40 years, half of the world's wildlife has disappeared.
That's awful.
It's shocking. It's just so shocking. And it's, in a way, it's no surprise, but you look at it, you look at the way we've treated the wild animals around us right here. You look at what we've done to the oceans. I mean, as a diver, I'm acutely aware of how incredibly different it is to dive these days. Mm. You know, things have been just massacred out of existence, you know. So that's what I think making guitars is quite low on my priority. And I have my guitar.
Yeah, that's very true. I don't think you need a replacement anytime soon. Brian, it's been wonderful. A real pleasure to talk to you and to witness the Red Special.
Thank you
very much.
Pleasure.